You know, so we are going to have a very interesting session because I don't know if how many of you were there for the morning address by Prime Minister Modi and Minister Prasad, and they were talking about India as the nation of startups. We are seeing a lot of activity, lot of buzz, lot of noise, and lot of rightful noise, I would say, around startups. And Minister Prasad said that every day we are having, we are seeing 3-4 startups come in India. And in any country, if you see, be it US, which is considered the number one startup destination in the world, or Israel, which is the second startup destination in the world, and India, which is third, any country which is progressing and making the huge leap forward is being triggered by startups, and it's very necessary for us to celebrate, to appreciate, and then to participate in this startup growth story. And I'm very honored today to be moderating some of the most respectable pioneers in this space. Saurabh Srivastava needs no introduction. All of you in this room must be knowing him. But if you don't, then today is a great chance to know him, because he's the founding, he's considered the founding father, if I may say so, of angel and VC investing in India. So he's been doing it way, way before we saw all the new age venture capitalists come in this country. In fact, I was just discussing with him, he launched the first fund which was placing bets and investing in companies, and he considers, and he still continues to do that at, you know, leading from the forefront, and invested in hundreds and hundreds of companies which have become large. So very honored to have you with us. Bipin, Preet needs again no introduction, because he's one of our very successful stories, startup stories from India. MobiKwik is relentlessly leading in the payment gateways. He's doing great stuff, and the company just continues to grow. And Professor Anil Gupta, again, someone we all know, and what can I say about him? great leader, innovator, champion of change, if India has seen one, then I think his name should come in the forefront. I've seen how passionately he has devoted his life to ensuring inclusive growth, to ensuring entrepreneurship grows, not just the unicorns that we hear about, but micro entrepreneurship. And he does it with all his heart. And the efforts are to be seen with the honeybee network that he has. We have Dr. Biplav Srivastav. I'm hoping he's here, because I cannot see him. So he's here. And with that, today what we are going to be discussing is technology startups disrupting the growth curve. So we all agree that they're disrupting the growth curve. But what I would urge our panelists to talk about is what has been their experience in seeing and witnessing and participating in the growth story which the startups are writing in India. And may I request Saurabh to please you know, share his views on this. On
thank you, Shradha. I think, as you said, it's important to understand the role that startups play and how critical they are. And there are three roles that startups actually play in disrupting growth and, in fact, everything else. They're the primary creator of jobs globally. And there's US data done in a study by Kauffman Foundation, which says that for 40 years that they did this analysis, except for 7 years in between, for 33 years, all net new jobs in the US were created by startups. So they're primary creator of employment. If you just look at India itself, we have what is called the IT industry, 30 years ago, when I'd founded NASSCOM, we were a $50 million industry. It did not exist. Last year, it was $160 billion. Direct, indirect employment of about 10 million. Largest single employer in the organized private sector. This is an industry, except for the Tata Group, almost entirely startups. So it's a huge creator of employment. Same thing with economic growth. You look at the countries that Shradha talked about, the United States. Israel lives in a very difficult neighborhood, but is the only developed country in that whole area. What is it going for it? Startups, mostly technology startups. So on all of these fronts, startups are disruptive, and basically what startups do is they do a form of what I call triangulation. They project what human needs, what consumer needs are going to be in the future. Then they also see and project how technology is going to evolve. They try and find that intersection. And then they look at how they will create the right business models so that the solutions they create that people need will become affordable to those people. And that is how disruption happens, that's how evolution happens, and that is how startups end up also dramatically changing people's lives. So it's not just about economic growth, it's not only about employment, it's also improving human lives. So you look around and say, how have startups changed the way we live and we communicate and whatever we do? So, and they keep mutating, so they don't stay static. So look at Google. It started as a search engine. When I had to leave from my office to come here, I had to depend on Google Maps. But guess what? Google is also going to make cars. So it's going to become an automobile company. I don't think that is what the intention was when they started. Facebook is looking at becoming a communications company. They're going to launch balloons and basically create a communications infrastructure. WhatsApp was a messaging service, but most of us know that we make phone calls on WhatsApp. This keeps changing. It keeps changing how you live, how you communicate, and in every way, how you operate. Let's look at India itself. I mean, I was talking of global examples in India. In India, one technology, which is mobile phones, has completely empowered 1 billion citizens. How we live today has changed. For people in remote areas, it's one of the most empowering tools today. There's a mobile phone. And what are startups doing in India? Shradha mentioned that we are now number 3. There's every reason we should keep creeping up that curve. So I'll give you, I talked about the IT service industry, but that's not the only place where change is happening. So let me give you some examples of what startups are doing, which will change dramatically what we do. So there's a startup which is growing human liver and cornea, and it will then look at doing other organs. It'll completely change how testing is done for drugs. It will also change how things get transplanted. There's another startup which is looking at monitoring your brain so that every time somebody has an accident or blacks out, you don't have to go do an MRI. You don't have to do a CAT scan. This is a device which, without that kind of cost and without that kind of invasion, is going to give you the first level answer. There's a startup which is going to do a test for diabetes at 5 rupees. and it will be done remotely. So you will not need the kind of machine you need today. There's a startup which is taking a very expensive machine when people get put on ventilation machines in hospitals. It's creating a portable device. You can have it at home, right here in India. Just think of what will happen when they get going within India. Just look at Delhi's air. Who do you think is going to fix it? There hasn't been very encouraging signs of where it'll get fixed in government. But guess what? There are a lot of startups that are working on it. And my suspicion is within the next 2 years, 3 years, startups will fix it. So there's a startup which has got a device which you can attach onto your chimneys in offices. You can attach to the exhaust of your car. And it will not allow PM 2.5 particles to come out. There are already startups that have solutions for farmers to not do the burning of their stubble. I'm just giving you a few examples because the loads of them, I'm only talking of companies where I have personally looked at and even invested. So these are all very real. Again, there are startups that are working in the agriculture field. They're seeing how you can remotely sense the soil, how you can irrigate it. There are startups working on models for clean energy. And very often, startups are not necessarily creating new technology, but creating business models through which existing technology can become available. So there are startups that are taking solar power. They're going to a village. They set it up. They haven't invented any of those devices. But they're creating a business model where they get it financed. And they tell rural households that for the same amount of money that you spend on kerosene, I will give you solar power. So they're just creating a great solution through a business model. And we should respect that because I guess the biggest marks I would give Google today is not on their technology, but on their business model. See how all of us are dependent on Google, but they're the biggest advertising company. They want to be the biggest job search engine, the biggest marriage portal, the biggest place for real estate. All of us who are using Google are not paying for it. Somebody else is paying. And they are highly profitable. So business models make a lot of sense. So I just wanted to, I didn't want to go on and on because it'll be good if we have more Q&A. But I just wanted to end by saying that if you look at India today, we have huge challenges in many areas, and we have them on scale. So we have challenges, for example, in healthcare. Not enough people have access to affordable healthcare. So apart from some of the things that I was talking about, there are startups that are building a model where they will now use communications and artificial intelligence. And in remote areas where doctors will not go, or at least good doctors will not go, you can actually do remote diagnostics through a lot of diagnostic equipment, which again is being developed, which is less invasive. And you will have remotely the ability to diagnose correctly. And that all of this will come through technology, leveraging of technology, increasing leverage of artificial intelligence. And unlike concerns of where artificial intelligence will kill jobs, there are huge examples where artificial intelligence correctly used will actually create jobs. So if you look at our challenges in healthcare, in education, in agricultural productivity, many of these areas, they will get resolved by startups leveraging technology. Because we have the advantage that we have these challenges on scale, many countries do, but we also have world-class entrepreneurs. We develop or have access to the kind of technology we need. And to my mind, we may be number three today. We were number four in terms of startup hub a couple of years ago. I clearly see ourselves as being one of the two startup hubs, number one and number two startup hubs in the world 5 years from now. I think, Shradha, most of your data will support that. And at that time, it will, the challenges and the problems that we're solving and our startups are solving are problems that actually are not necessarily going to get solved in the developed world, because these are not problems of the developed world, and startups there are not focused on it. But as we solve these problems for India, even in healthcare, medical devices at an affordable cost, these solutions will go global, and it won't be just disruption in India. Our startups will end up disrupting global markets. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Saurabh. Very relevant points. I'm going to come back to you on one question, which I'm sure many in the audience would also have, is that, you know, there's so much of buzz around startups, Startup India and everything, but somewhere there is also this thing that it's too much of noise, and startup world has not still seen, it's still very risk, very high risk, and we've still not seen the kind of returns in India. And you particularly as an investor, how do you see that? And we'll come to you on that question. So Bipin, before I come to you, I would like to talk to Professor Anil Gupta. Sir, I have one question for you. Of course, please address the startup thing. But one question is, you know, in India, whenever I travel across the world, one thing, the question which is being raised is that India does not build for India. Indian startups don't build for Indian startups. Indian startups build, they copy a lot of things that have worked internationally very well. And the startup scene in India is seeing the big companies are basically a prototype of what has happened in US market, what has succeeded. I'm asking you this question because you champion India and localization. How do you see that? And do you think moving forward, we will see a lot of startups building for India?
You know, the paradox, Shradha, is that these are the startups which get money. The one who ape, the one who imitate, the one who tweak a little bit and then come out with a slightly variable variation on the theme, they get the money. But no. I will tell you why. The tragedy is that, let us take the case of urinary tract infection, which women suffer from. Yeah. My wife needed a test. It takes 3 days, 72 hours to get the report. Young student under Suman Kapoor, BITS Pilani Hyderabad campus, has developed an antibiotic finder. There are 14 different kinds of infection. There are 14 different antibiotics. This machine will tell you in 4 hours. Wow. Is this enterprise getting money? No. So what I'm saying is that you have a 2D X-ray. You can't have MRI in small blocks and districts. A surgery has to be done. There's an accident. You need to know exactly how the bones are fractured or damaged. Vikas has developed algorithm which will convert a 2D image into 3D and help the surgeon to do surgery appropriately, almost giving him insight which an MRI would have given. How much investment has he got? There is a person, there's an entrepreneur, Amit, who has a suitcase size kit, 36 tests in 1 hour in 250 rupees. Equistar, how much investment has he got? I recently got his meeting with Dr. Devishetty because I thought like Devishetty will understand what he's doing and maybe he'll support him. The point I'm trying to drive home is that our VC industry and whatever else goes with it has no appetite for early stage technology ventures. Let me come to the other extreme. This is one side of the high tech. Let me go to the grassroots.
You know, if it was a newspaper, this is a headline.
You know,
yeah, this is a headline.
They are lying with huge funds unspent, uninvested.
Yeah.
Yesterday there was a news where they have shown how much of funds are lying without anybody being invested in.
Yeah.
So it is not that they are short of funds, but they are short of hunger. There is no appetite. Take the other case. Dharambir, a grassroots innovator. Yamunanagar, Damla village, has designed a food processing machine which will process your fruits and vegetables, particularly fruits, without crushing the seed. So if you have amla, it will crush the pith, but seed will be intact. If you have oranges, it will give you the juice without crushing the seed. You know, when you crush them, they become, juice will become bitter. And then on the top of it, it will extract essential oils from the seed. Show me one machine like that, at the cost at which he has done. Have you been able to scale it up? So, Rasing Daya, another biomass gasifier, 25,000 rupees per kilowatt. Biomass energy, one of the, Terry had considered it, is one of the most efficient biomass gasifier in Northeast and many other places we need it. What I'm trying to say is that it is not lack of technological innovation that is our problem. The problem is lack, the investment funnel is punctured. So you have some funds at early stage, it takes off. Then, it, you know, with Bayrak, which I had written the cabinet note for, and it is now one of the most aggressive institution within the public sector, within the government of India, which invests at the idea stage, biotechnology space. So you have, we give 15 fellowships of 15 lakh each to the students. Then they have big grant, which is 50 lakhs. After that, it becomes loan. You have to contribute 50% of your own money to get an investment from SIBRI. Now, how many innovators will be able to gather that kind of money from their own side? So we don't have a funnel from 5 lakh, 15 lakh, 50 lakhs, 1.5 crore, 2.5 crore, 5 crore, and then further. Then VCs can take over. But VCs will not intervene at the early stage when product is not yet ready or is in early stage. So my suggestion would be that if we really want the technology startups which can disrupt the current trends which we see in the marketplace, we have to change the ecosystem completely. You know, look at the fund of funds, 10,000 crores fund. I mentioned this in the previous government and I mentioned this in the current government. They don't realize that funds of funds will only invest when product has already gone to the market and proven itself. By that time, 90% startups are dead. By the time you go to the market and make your case, 90% of the high value, high innovation startups are already vanished. So what are we saying? We are investing far too little, far too late. And that's not going to make our system healthy. So we need to have early stage investments. India needs early stage investments. We need to broaden the funnel size so that large number of enterprises can be supported. You know what happens? I'll give you an example. There's an innovation. We give these fellowships, 15 lakh. Young people, given coming from middle class, can't sustain them even for 2 years. They go for a job. First a student, we give an award, that fellow goes away. Then second student comes, then he goes away. So what are we saying? How do we retain young people who are solving technological problems in persistent with that enterprise? So what are the things we can do? One, public procurement policy needs to be tweaked so that when you have proved the case, your technology is working very well, public procurement must give priority. When public procurement orders come, banks must give priority to finance that. If you have an order and you can't manufacture, there's no point. So we must have easy finance, early finance, agile finance for those startups which have crossed one hurdle of public procurement, which means quality standards. Yeah. Thirdly, we should also ensure that the testing of the products, which technology products require testing, because without them, you will not certify them. Without certification, nobody will order them. Banks will not finance them. So testing in public labs must be done at very concessional rate, if possible on deferred payment basis. If you succeed, we'll charge the fees. If you fail, we forget. Something of that. There must be a national fund for testing high-tech ventures, products of the high-tech ventures, because that is the very costly part. Clinical trials, you know how much it takes? Yeah. So therefore, when medical devices are involved, when other devices are involved, there's a huge regulatory cost that must be there, but can we make it easier for these startups to move forward? So I will only say that there is a great richness in the ecosystem so far as innovations are concerned. Where do we lack? In testing, in funding, in creating a smooth passage for them to grow up. And finally, in public procurement, because the state governments, which have to really procure these solutions, do not have a clear guideline as to how will they procure something for which there is no 3 years balance sheet and there is no proof of market. They're still at the earliest stage. hardly any state at this moment is aggressive enough to procure under single tender from one startup who has no other comparison, because that's an innovation product. Yeah. So you obviously can't benchmark it with somebody else. So I think we need a lot of reforms in our system. We are moving in that direction. That is the positive side, is that we are moving in that direction. Now, it is much easier for startups to fulfill requirement within 3 years or 5 years, they can fulfill requirement. New policy has made many concessions, but I think we need to make many more.
I'm going to come back to you with a question. You're so passionate and you know everything. Why haven't you raised a fund and start investing in startups? I'm asking
there
you.
There is a small fund we created. I don't have a big pocket, but we have a fund of 22 lakhs. I put my own savings and some of my friends.
Now that deserves a clap, no? That he's doing it.
I'm doing it.
Yeah, his own SIF, savings.
SIF.sarchi.org.
Yeah.
So I will do what I'm talking about. I'm practicing what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
We give early. I'll give you a small example. A bit planning student showed me very interesting thing. You take a half, when you have a hard-boiled egg, the shell is there. You dissolve the shell in a solvent. You know what will be left behind? A collagen layer. The collagen layer is a very good water filter. That was a remarkable idea. I said, I will fund it. How much money do you need, sir? About 10,000 rupees. I said, take 25,000 rupees.
Wow.
Try to test it out. Problem is that many of these students, I can't retain them in this business because the middle class pressure of the family is so much. So we should think of attractive startup fellowships.
Yeah.
You know, we should sustain them for 2, 3 years, 4 years, so that during the struggle period, the parental pressure can be warded off and they can persist with their ideas.
Yeah. I hope the front row here is listening because they are government officials and they can make the difference. Yeah, thank you. Bipin, to you, you are the entrepreneur. You represent the new India. You've started up. Two things I want to ask you. One is the risk, right, of doing your own thing. You took the risk. How did you manage to take the risk? How have you managed to retain and sustain and grow? And second is, from an innovation standpoint, how would you say that the payment gateway, the product that you built, is localized, is made for India? How are you doing that?
Sure. So first of all, thanks for having me here, and it's a pleasure to address this audience. Let me first say, you know, a couple of things about technology. I think, you know, with due respect to all other professions, technology is the most exciting field to be in today. And, you know, in modern human society, there is no other field which is making the kind of impact on human life as technology is. With all its failures, with all the things that are not working out today, technology is the greatest enabler for modern human life. You look at the market cap of the biggest 10 companies in the world. The top 5 companies are purely technology companies. And they have a GDP, combined market cap, which is more than India's GDP, 5 companies. So clearly, you know, technology is a great field to be in. And I personally started, I've been an engineer, I passed out of IIT Delhi, and I worked in a job for 7 years. I worked in companies like Intel, I worked in the semiconductor area, but you know, found that nothing much is happening in India as far as semiconductors is concerned. So I thought I'll start a company. And when I mentioned this idea, and I come from a pretty, you know, lower middle class kind of background, you know, where we really took a loan to get me through IIT, and then, you know, getting a job was the biggest event in our family. You know, because I being the eldest son in the family, and I became the primary wage earner in the family. So after working for 7 years, when I mentioned this idea to my family, especially my mom, she thought I must have gone crazy, because I had overcome great odds just to get into IIT and then get a job which was stable and start earning money. And so it was ludicrous. You know, after having worked for 7 years and with not much of savings, you know, I just decided to jump in. But today when I look back, you know, and I have spent roughly half my, you know, career working in other companies, and half of my career, 7, 8 years, running MobiKwik, I think it's been a life-changing event. As a person, I have developed in ways that I could not have if I had been just working a job. I think just starting something, building something, hiring people, working with other people, and creating economic value, which is valued by customers, which is valued by investors, which is valued by businesses. I think that is just an amazing feeling to have. And today, I'm pretty lucky to be here. I mean, of course, luck has played a great role, because when I started, the ecosystem in India was, so just you could have this front row people coming in for any kind of a startup event, right? And you started at the same time, right? And from there, now we have gone to a level where the Prime Minister, and the government talks about startups in such a big way. So I think we must appreciate that we have come a really, really long way as a country in terms of startups. Of course, a lot of things have changed. Internet has happened, mobile phone has happened, and now payments and financial services are happening via technology in a big way. So I think India today is, one of the three, I would say, countries, USA, China, and India, represent really the three big markets for technology as well as creators of technology. And we're seeing that happening in a very big way. The business that we are in, which is payments and financial services, has a huge benefit from technology. Like if you look at India, though we have 600, 700 million bank accounts, the accessibility of banking and financial services is very, very low. If you look at credit penetration, it's one of the lowest in the world. If you look at insurance, China has gone to 97% insurance coverage. We are sitting at 3%. So clearly, in the world of financial services, technology has a great role to play. And today, with mobile phones, we have that technology available in everybody's hand, whether it is a small business or whether it is a consumer, and you could be living anywhere in the country. And thanks to cheap data, thanks to cheap smartphones, now we have technology available to everybody. And I think I must say this, that even from a policy point of view, right, especially this government, has done outstandingly well in terms of creating a very, very forward-looking policy in terms of evolution of financial services. I think the future looks really, really bright. To give you some statistics, digital payments today represent about $50 billion of transactions in India. But Morgan Stanley recently published a report where it clearly says that by 2020, this value is going to reach $500 billion. If you put that in the context of GDP, India's current GDP, which is around $2.26 trillion, that's about 25% of today's India's GDP in the next 3 years. That's because I think there is a huge latent demand for financial services, especially two areas which I am really passionate about, which are around lending and which are around insurance. And the way these industries are shaping up, the way modern banking is shaping up, is that banks are not able to reach out to the last mile of consumers, do not have the correct amount of data or the kind of data to make decisions on giving a loan to a customer or to offer an insurance, health insurance, to a customer. All of which technology solves, because if you use a smartphone and if you use it for payments, that is creating the huge distribution and data on which the financial services of lending and insurance can be built. So we are seeing that this and we're seeing, I think, hundreds of startups which have started in the last 18 months or so, which are attacking. Some people are working on two-wheeler loans, some people are working on credit of different kinds, some people are working on insurance, some people are creating just on the data side of it, on the credit enablement side of it. So it's I think especially when fintech is concerned, I would say today, India is the place to be in.
Yeah. Thanks, Bipin. Is Dr. Biplav there? He's there? He's joined? Okay, so question to you, Dr. Biplav. You're in IBM. You represent one of the largest corporates in the world, and I know that in India, IBM is now very actively engaging with startups. How do you see the role of corporates, particularly in a country like India? How can they work with startups to create more innovation? So we will wait till you make the phone call, and then we will go back to you. So what I was asking you, Saurabh, is, about this whole, and what Professor Gupta also mentioned, is why one is from a risk-taking ability, why don't we see enough risk being taken by the investor community in India, or are they taking, and we are not able to fully see? And second is from a return perspective, India has not seen great returns or even decent return. With the, at last count, I heard that in the startup space since 2007, 2008, around $23 to $24 billion have been invested, and the returns have been around $3 to $4 billion only.
I think there are, Shradha, there are very many questions embedded in that one question that you ask. So, as you would expect, there's no single answer to it. So let me pick up those one by one. Firstly, what Professor Gupta was saying is true. I think there isn't enough risk money going in to the very early stage startups. Bunch of reasons for that, not a single reason. One reason is simply that if you look at most of the VC money in India, it's really money from overseas, it's not domestic capital. And global money tends to go for higher stage risk in countries outside its own. So a Sequoia would take a very early stage risk in the US, it will not take that in India. And I don't mean Sequoia by name, but generally. We have had no domestic asset class of venture capital so far. So if you look at globally, where does that venture capital money come from? It comes from university endowments in the US, its pension funds, its sovereign wealth offices in Singapore, Middle East. India has no such source. Banks are not encouraged to lend, and banks are not the right people to put money in VC. Pension funds are not allowed to invest. VC industry in the US took off only when pension funds entered the picture. Till that law, VC industry didn't exist in the US. Our sovereign wealth funds don't exist and they don't invest in Indian funds. Our universities have no money to put in VC funds. So we have no domestic asset class. And that's the reason why the fund of funds of the government was important. It was attempting to create that stuff. It's early days. It's done a good job. It's sort of approved investment in 60, 70 funds. Out of this, half of them are first-time fund managers, domestic fund managers. So my sense is over the next 2 or 3 years, you will see a lot more domestic money. Because what is happening is the government only puts in 15, 20% of that corpus. 80% has to be raised. And all these people are out in the market trying to raise it from Indian family offices, from Indian HNIs. So I suspect some of this will get better. Remember, we are a very, very young scenario in VC investment. So Professor's lament is quite correct. This is one part of the reason that VCs don't want to take that early stage risk. They really want to see something on the table, something that's proven, a little bit of revenues, even if there are no profits and whatever. The second aspect is, even if you look at the US, the very early stage risk is not actually taken by VCs. In a typical year in the US, I have data for 2 or 3 years ago, VCs put in $25 billion in about 500 companies, 5,000 companies. Angels put in almost the same money, $26 billion, in 70,000 companies. Now, that's a pyramid. 1 in 10, 1 in 20 succeeds. it's a high risk, and then they get some VC money. Now in India, this pyramid is inverted. We have only a few hundred angels. In most countries in the world, because angels play such a key role, governments tend to incentivize them. The UK gives 30 to 50% tax credit. Every state in the US, even today, even though they don't need to, provide incentives for angels to invest. Singapore has tax credits, all of them. In India, forget tax credits. We tax angel investments. And we don't seem to be able to get rid of that. So it's not a very friendly environment from that viewpoint, right? And who are angels? So angels are not Rockefellers and Fords, and leave alone Ratan Tata. It's not the Birlas and Sanghanias and everybody else. Angels are generally first generation middle class entrepreneurs for whom being in business was an accident, not destiny. So once you do it once or twice, people like us, we tire of it, we don't enjoy it. And we say, fine, we'll get vicarious pleasure in investing in youngsters and mentoring them. And if they do well, fine, we'll do well. And if they don't do well, anyway, you're enjoying it, right? You think you're giving something back. In India, the reason you don't have that many angels is because first generation entrepreneurship is barely two decades old. So you don't have enough people who have been through one or more cycle of wealth creation who are getting into angel investing. Yeah. There is an explosion. If you just look, you would have the data, Shraddha, on this. Is this 10 years ago, there were almost nothing, and it slowly ramped up. If I just take the example of IAN, 10 years ago, we had 6-7 people as part of the angel group. We would see 200 entrepreneurs struggle to do one investment. Now it's over 450. And you're doing a lot more. So it's a second strand. One is it's mostly overseas capital. B, there's no domestic capital. Very few domestic fund managers. C, not sufficient angel investors. Then there are other aspects. You know, if you look at our entrepreneurs, this whole entrepreneurial explosion, again, is recent, 10, 15 years ago, right? So our entrepreneurs are not as seasoned as they would be in the US or Israel. They don't know how to package their idea. They may have a great idea or technology. They don't always know how to create the right business model around it. This comes with experience. This comes with other mentors being around. The whole ecosystem isn't there yet to support them do it. But that's a challenge. And again, I think Professor Gupta is right. Many of these great ideas don't get invested in. And they would probably get invested in if they were in the Israel or in the US, because you'd have the ecosystem would come, mentor them. Many of them would talk to 10 other entrepreneurs and they would know how to put a plan. The big difference that people tell me when they look at, even at the angel stage, when entrepreneurs are pitching their plans versus when they're doing it in Silicon Valley or in Israel, those guys are much more sophisticated about how they put it together and present it. This is happening, though. This will come. Yeah. And he is right in the sense that people say that, no, there's no innovation in India. That's not true. There is serious innovation in India. The capital that you talked about on return, you know, this again gets confused because everybody is looking at this big number. But guess what? You know, 80% of it went to four companies. So let's take those four companies aside. The people who put in money in Flipkart and Ola at the valuation at which they did only have themselves to blame if they're not getting a return, because those, to my mind, were not very wise decisions. Okay. People have put in money in Flipkart at a valuation that they would have had if they were in the US, but they have only a fraction of the market, yeah. Right? So these are investors who just want to own the market.
Yeah.
And so if I took all of that money away, then the situation is quite different. I will tell you the for example, returns on angel investments. They're high. I've made almost 80 investments in the last 17 years. My IRR is 82%. IRR of the Indian Angel Network is 32%. And we are investing in all the things I talked about. These are seed. People have started. They have no revenues, no profits. So it's not that you won't. But remember that in India, the market is still growing. We are still not the size of a US economy. We are not the size of a Chinese economy. So I don't think we should expect that there'll be those kind of things. But to say that venture funds cannot get a 20 or 30% IRR return, this is not actually true. It's not true. So I think our data is kind of corrupted by the very large numbers of money going into half a dozen companies. Yeah, and those companies, to my mind, I would put them aside. They're all work in process. It's still not very clear how many will survive or not. And the guys who are putting in money know exactly what they're doing.
That's very good to hear. Yeah, because I think somehow we celebrate too much of investors in our country. You know, one thing, Saurabh, I was thinking that, you know, when the funding happens, we say $1 million. But $1 million looks one number. But if you see in Indian rupees, then it becomes 6.5 crores. 6.5 crores sounds very big. So shouldn't we start saying funding ko in crores because we operate in India?
And we should. And I'll tell you, $1 billion is, at this early stage, I mean, Professor Gupta was talking about 10, 20,000 rupees. Actually, in many of these ideas, they need 10, 15 lakhs to actually get it going. And the average investment in the angel network is only 2 to 3 crores. It's not, I mean, they need lots of money, but not at that point. And I think it will come. I would hope it comes. And some of the schemes that he was talking about, the paper he wrote on Bayrak is excellent. Bayrak is doing excellent work. So there is a combination of things that is happening. Niti Aayog is doing its own thing on funding on different types of incubators. Different schemes are coming up. So I would say this, that I think we are at the cusp. Yes, we are not there. We are a very, very young movement on startups. The pace at which things have happened and how the ecosystem is building up, both from the government side and alongside that which is happening on the private side, I find is encouraging. And I think in another 2-3 years from now, you will find really good innovation getting the funding that it does deserve. And some changes in government regulations which actually encourage that, I think that ecosystem will come in place. So I mean, I'm optimistic, although I entirely agree that there are a lot of gaps. But I don't honestly know of any country in the world which has sprinted as fast as we have in this space in the last 5 or 6 years.
Absolutely, very true. I think India is the startup destination of the world. It has to be number one in maybe 2 years from now. Do we have? He's not there. So we will. How much time do we have left? Half an hour. So should we start taking questions from the audience? Please do, and please keep your questions very, very short. Yes. And very, very fast, so we can take as many questions. Yes?
My name is Ajay Mutreja. I've been involved with startup, almost 1,500 of these. One of the problems that I see is that majority of the innovations that are being done in India are not addressing the real challenges of the corporate world. So there are many funds available at angel level or through academic engineering partnerships like corporate innovations. Even SERB, Science and Engineering Research Board under the DST, provides up to 50 lakh funding from the government. So there are available funds for solving the problems of lack of funds for innovative ideas that you talked about. And there are today 122 social impact funds available. I'm also involved with some of them. So funding is not a problem. The scale-up is also...
Ajay, go to one thing. Go to gyti.techpedia.in. Techpedia.in has 200,000, information of 200,000 engineering projects done by 500,000 students of this country. Open source, no password required, just scan it. And find out how many ideas that you find. Have you ever heard of a black box for an automobile? Do you know how much useful it can be for the insurance sector? Because the insurance claimant, the agents, write stories actually when the claim has to be written, isn't it? There's no data. A black box will give you the data whether the driver was driving it slowly, properly or not. Where was it developed? Four girls in Women Polytechnic in Latur. Can you imagine that? Mrs. Mirgarkar was her guide. Thanks, bless that lady who guided students on a project for which there was no template. No IT had done that. I'm talking about a polytechnic. Forget about engineering college. What are you talking about funds being available? Look at this data, find out empirically, find out how many of them have received calls from investors, social impact funds, they want 30% return. How many of them, the early stage ventures can give you that return at this stage when they are still developing technology or product? So please, let us not miss the point, which is that large number of young people in our country are doing very meaningful work. A ceramic unit, Morbi cluster, a small ceramic unit needs an image processing device which will check whether or not the tiles are of proper surface quality and the thickness is uniform. A polytechnic student develops a small image processing device. Did he get any support? No, he's doing 6,000 rupees job somewhere. So let us accept that, except for biotech, where biotech is playing a very pivotal role, in other fields of engineering and technology, we have no funds available to invest in the ideas of students at an early stage. No funds, zero. And with having spent 30 years in this area, I should know. I mean, how would anybody tell me that there are funds? This database is available on the web. So therefore, it is all empirical.
So
talk to those people, check with them. Did they get any call? I know Gita is here. Department of Electronics had a very good fund where they set up these incubators. I think up to 25 lakhs used to invest, right? Per startup. And I know that in Hyderabad and many other places, 2007. Now that was one window for electronics and sensor-based technology that has been closed down. She can't do it anymore. So what are we talking about? Instead of opening more windows, we are closing down that exist. I don't think that it is a very nice thing to say, but I should say this because there are policymakers here. Every state government, every ministry should think of replicating BIREC experience. We need 50 BIRECs in this country, in each vertical, in transport. I mean, how do you judge innovation? Unit cost of any activity in the economy must go down. That is innovation. So if it costs 5 crore rupees to make 1 kilometer of road, it should cost 4 crore rupees. That is innovation, isn't it? That is a universally accepted unit of innovation. It should reduce cost and give me same or better service. Now, we know that Malaysia used up to 20% of waste plastic. Mr. Gadkari very fortunately has very much favored this policy that, you know, we can use waste plastic, granularize it, mix it with the bitumen, you can save 20% bitumen, that cost goes down. But very pilot scale, it is not a big policy. If it becomes a policy that public, that no highway will be built without 20% of content being waste plastic, you will solve the Swachhata mission problem and you will also generate large number of entrepreneurs who will give this material to the build contract to the road builders. We need that kind of linkage.
Absolutely. Absolutely. What's the next question?
It's not a question. I think it's a...
And also, you know, be very generous. I know it's after lunch, but he's speaking so passionately. Clap very loudly. Yes, next question, please.
I just want to say something. Like, he's saying he has got access to all those, you know, innovative guys who are doing good in the country, right? And right now we just heard there are, you know, ample amount of fund. So I think there is a need to bridge that gap, right? So that, you know, those questions which get answered so that the fund reaches to them and the government is doing, may not be doing enough. So what is that required so that the flow, you know, flow is, you know, very fluent?
to these startups? Saurabh has already answered that question, that most of the funds lack hunger to engage at the early stage when innovators are in the product development phase or product testing phase or product maturation phase. At that stage, funds don't invest. And that is the stage when highest mortality takes place. So there is a problem here. Problem is of the ecosystem in which we have not yet found resources to help 1,000 flowers bloom to the extent that they will then attract the investors to invest in them. So I'm not saying that there are not enough funds. Of course there are funds. But they, for them, there too, they will enter the market, the investments place much later. Isn't it, Saurabh? Don't you agree with that?
So would you like to address this question? No,
this is a very amazing question. We can keep discussing this for months. There's no answer, so let's go to the next.
No,
we will have to figure
I think this is the important, and this is the important question which should be answered, because...
No, so I think, but what we need to do is think about it, deliberate.
He want to say something.
Who?
See, there are funds available from DFID, which is High Commission of UK and India. There are funds available from USAID. So I've been involved with many of those funds, and there are funds available up to 2 crore rupees only at the idea stage. So let's not say there are no funds available. They may be limited. And obviously, you have to go through the jury selection process. It takes a few...
So I'm going to now move from here to the next question, because I will talk as an entrepreneur and for startups in India. Funds are available, but they don't invest in innovation. I'm a witness. I've been here 9 years, spoken, written about 72,000 entrepreneurs, and I see that money, people are sitting over it. Jaise ki sahi baat bataun, Latur koi investor chal ke nahi jayega, na to flight lega. You have to come to Delhi, Bombay, or Bangalore, so investors don't even do that. So let me not begin there, but we need to find a solution. Let's move to the next question.
Sir, my request is there any central agency which can guide on various steps to the startup, whether it might be the financial, technical, or any sort of the things? Is there any agency in the country?
Atal Innovation Mission is there, Niti Aayog, they are doing quite a lot of effort in educating people about the startup policy. Every state government has a startup policy now. Most of the state governments have a startup policy. Some of them have, huh? Yes, what I'm saying is that when many states have now opened a single window registration, Ministry of Department of Industry in Gujarat does it, Bihar, Andhra Pradesh, Telangana, many states are doing that. So I think on that front, they're doing their bit. They're at least providing hassle-free registration of startup. A lot of states are doing
startup
that.
India website is
also there. Yes, there. You can online apply and you get the response very quickly.
That is at the initial stage. I'm asking after 6 months, 1 year or 2 years, suppose any startup has any sort of the problem, so who will sort that problem? This is my query, not the registration part of that or the guiding part of that. Suppose I got a startup today. After 6 months, I got a problem. After 1 year, I got a different problem. So is there any sort of...
There are some incubators. There are about, I would say, more than 500 to 600 incubators, NSTDB, National Science and Technology Enterprise Development Board, Entrepreneurship Development Board, which is DST umbrella, under which large number of incubators have been set up in engineering colleges, academic institutions. Plus, as I said, Department of Electronics had set up many incubators. ICMR is trying to set up incubators. Department of Biotechnology has BioNest and other incubators. So large number of incubators there in science and technology space. About others, CI, Center for Entrepreneurship, Innovation and Entrepreneurship at IMA, that is for general enterprises. Entrepreneurship Development Institute, EDI, has an incubator for general business enterprises.
There are many institutions, but I wanted to make a more generic point. See, doing a startup is not an easy business. It's not a cakewalk. And it is up to the startup to actually find the places where it can get that help. It's not anybody's responsibility to do it. And that is the reason the failure rate is high. That's the reason the successes are few. But those successes are big. So startups should not expect to be handheld every inch of the way. So don't expect that. There is enough happening that you can reach out and find, but it's not easy. Expect it to be hard.
Yes.
Let me add just a very small counter to this narrative. I think, see, world over, there is a difference between engineers, slash scientists slash innovators and entrepreneurs. So there is a bridge. Going from inventing something new is a different, entirely a different skill versus trying to set up a new business. I've done it myself. You know, it's a lifestyle choice that not everybody can make. And not everybody is ready to make. It's a hustle, it's a struggle. So just inventing something is probably 50% of it. I think the remaining 50% goes to the people, you know, whether, of course, access to information, access to resources plays a large role. But I would like to believe that today in the connected world that we live in, there is sufficient information available that if a scientist or an innovator wants to really set up a business, there will be, you know, so the 99 times, first 99 times, I went to any investor for money, right? I got declined. The first, we didn't raise money for 4 years after starting my business. I put my own, some of my own money, you know, I borrowed from other people, etc. It took time. It takes time. Not everybody is good at dealing with investors or going to investors or raising funds, or it's hustle. I think so. Therefore, that's my just very small bit of, you know, counter to the narrative.
Absolutely, absolutely. Very good point, and that's why it's called entrepreneurship and starting up. So now we have Dr. Biplav. He's been here since last 1 hour listening to us, and I hope all of you can see him. Dr. Biplav, can you hear me? And I'm assuming you can hear me, and there's a way to reach you. My question, which I asked earlier, you are from IBM, which is one of the most innovative, large corporates, and operating here out of India. What is your thought on how can corporates be more involved with startups, which will lead to more innovation?
So hi everyone, and thank you for bearing with me over the VC. I'm very honored to be talking to you, and I thank all the support staff helping me connect here. So I wrote a small blog to put my point of view in case I don't get through, and it is shared. The main thing which I wanted to say was that while we have all the problems of funding, which I keep hearing, I also feel that we should be able to connect to the weakest and the most neediest of people who need our help. So I don't know if you can see my slides, but I had prepared a small slide, and what again, the main point which I was trying to say here was that not many. Yeah, it is disabled actually. So anyway. Okay. Thank you. So my main point was that, you know, the Gandhiji's main point was that whenever you want to do something for people, think about the weakest and the neediest. Okay. And when we think about startups and how many downloads we are having and so on, the main problem of the neediest and the weakest is about basic things like air, water, food, safety, health, education. And how many of our solutions or apps, they are having users of hundreds of millions, let alone billions. So I think there is a lot that needs to be done. Now, most of the startups of course, they have to think about the money part all as well. And they have been focusing on business models which have worked in the past. So they have been focusing on entertainment, or they have been focusing on food and so on. So I'm just sharing my screen, and so but the thing is, that India, its strength is the people, which is more than a billion, the mobiles, which are more than a billion, and the youth, which is willing to break its unproductive, whatever may be considered unproductive in the legacy. Now, the other thing is, because I am coming from an AI computer science background, I will have to talk about data. So there's plenty of data which is becoming increasingly available, things like open data. So it was nice to hear that when all the discussion on air pollution was being done, people were talking about air quality index. Now, having worked in smarter cities areas for the last six, 7 years, I realized that people would actually just say that there is a lot of pollution, but not get quantitative. So it's very heartening to see that people are talking about AQI now. And similarly, whether it is food prices and agriculture prices in the mandi, there are apps which are coming up. But again, the point is, it's not hundreds of millions of users. So in this kind of context, I think it is very important to engage people in whatever solutions we come up with. And we have done our own small work in bringing water quality information to people, whether it is through chatbots, through mobile apps. And in fact, we have released the Water Watch app, which is available on Android Store. And even its source code is available so that others can actually build upon it. And the thing is, we have to connect to the people's problems and also at the same time, figure out business models, how we will get money. But the thing is, the biggest of the apps, right, with the hundreds of millions or billions of dollars, they actually are free. They're giving value to people for free, whether it is a Facebook app or it is someone else's app, right? So we have to figure out innovative ways that the things get paid. So in summary, what I think is the focus areas that we need, one is crowdsourcing. So we are not involving people in our solutions, whether they are as sensors for data, how much pollution we have, we can just crowdsource and get it. But we have not been able to get that kind of scale. And about how to manage problems in a timely manner. People solve their own problems. So if it is traffic and there's a lot of jam, making that information available, people can adjust. We have to figure out ways to crowdsource, use crowdsourcing effectively. Next is to promoting open data, because data is the fuel for the new economy. And at the same time, respecting data privacy. So whatever is the privacy issues, we have to handle it, but we have to scale, figure out ways to scale. Business model I've already talked about. And the main thing is that everything doesn't have to be paid by end user. New ways have to be found out. And finally, we have to promote ideas, best of the research ideas in getting to this. I think this is one area where a lot needs to be done, and it comes from data and engaging people and students. So that's all my things where I wanted to share with you, and I'm happy to take any questions. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Biplav. That was very informative. Do we have time for more questions? 15 minutes more? That's amazing. Do you have any questions? Please ask.
Can yes, madam. Yes. Yes, madam, I am waiting actually. Yeah.
Who's waiting?
My question is to Saurabh, sir. I would like to have your opinion and advice. See, I am looking for the growth funding. And I have two offers to my investor. One is through the private placement, offering the equities, and we are planning for next 3 years for IPO. And one is my business model offers 24% to 28% with a lock-in period of 1 year, and after 1 year, consecutive 3 years, that investor has a 24% to 36% per annum, and next 3 years with the exit mode. What is trend says for today's scenario and your advice, sir?
Yeah, I think, you know, this is, if I answer your question and give you advice based on the limited information you've given me, I may end up giving you the wrong advice. So this is something that's very complex. You need to have a more, much more depth information on what you do, but I'll give you a generic feel. See, when you invite an investor and they're going to take a risk on you, then they are making what you would call a risk investment. And you have no way of guaranteeing them 26 or 28%, which is like a debt instrument. So you kind of have to make sure that there is a construct which balances the risk and the reward. So eventually it will be really, you'll have investors who like A and who like B. It's your choice of who you want with you. Okay.
My question is, I'm Ganesh. Basically, I have a question on, in terms of various technologies that have come up in the last 10 years, be it your Uber, which has come up in a big way in from the US, then we had Airbnb, then we have Elon Musk.
So these are less technologies, they are more business models.
Okay. So Elon Musk, for example, the driverless cars, etc., which are coming up. So most of these large innovations are coming out of other countries, like US is the primary source.
Yeah.
So in India, if you see the last 10 years, the companies which have multiplied in terms of revenue are the e-commerce companies, mainly which have grown substantially. So what needs to be done for building the startup ecosystem? Do we have a paradigm shift in our education, in our culture, in our thinking? How do you nurture such thoughts? How do you...
Firstly, let me correct you. The people who've seen great growth in their revenues are not the Flipkarts. They are the TCS and Infosys and Wipro and the IT service companies. So these are more sexy because they've seen more growth in the amount of money they have raised. Not in the revenues they have got, not in the profits. So I don't want you to confuse the whole issue. Okay, just to clarify that these are yet to be proven models. So Flipkart and Ola are in no way, to my mind, the... So I would not say that these are in any way the epitome of what entrepreneurship or successful companies are about. These are companies that have yet to be successful. I think look around at entrepreneurs across the piece. They are in many areas. It's not just in an e-commerce place. They are in IT services. They are in healthcare. They're in consumer goods. There is medical devices. They're in a whole host of areas. And if we look at India, the biggest thing we need is not to have 10 Flipkarts. There are massive challenges and massive big problems. And you can build big and scalable companies around them. And people are doing that and actually are very successful. They're not as sexy because they don't need to raise as much money. And do realize, if you look around the world, that the best companies actually got there without raising a lot of money. Amazon, Google didn't raise a lot of money. The only profitable internet company today in India, which is InfoEdge or Naukri.com, didn't even raise 100 crores, forget millions. So we shouldn't confuse the issue. In terms of the ecosystem, as we were talking earlier, it is coming in place. And it needs all of those. Yes, it needs academia to begin to teach entrepreneurship, to have incubators. It needs a cultural shift where we are beginning to accept failure, accept that people will become entrepreneurs rather than join a multinational. Parents have got to be ready to marry off their daughters to somebody who's not in government or in an MNC, but is doing a startup. So a lot of things have to happen. The good thing is they're beginning to happen. Entrepreneurship is becoming aspirational because there are so many good success stories, so many precedents. So people can look around and say, listen, you can be an entrepreneur and you can do all that. So it is happening. Changes are happening. Are they all there? No. We have some ways to go.
Yes. Yeah. Ask. You can shout. Be entrepreneurial.
So as you said, it's very tough for people to post for anything.
It's very tough for students to get seed funding for the innovation and ideas. Now, I myself, I'm a student. I'm working on innovation in my college. So what advice do you have to, when looking for mentorship and seed money?
To which college?
Triple IIT Delhi.
Sorry?
Triple IIT Delhi.
Well, Triple IIT Delhi is planning to set up a big incubator. If you have that, you should go talk to Pankaj Jalote.
Yeah.
They have somebody who's running an incubator. And you should try and get the first level of mentoring right from there to give you help in what you're trying to put together. And then you'll have others. And they have plans, I can tell you now, of setting up a very big incubation facility. So it will happen in your college.
So any general advice for all the students?
No, I would say for all the students who are here, particularly from the field of electronics and information technology, we really need three new innovations in ecosystem. One, different kind of entrepreneurs must set up their own incubator. I hope to persuade him to set up and announce one today in the area where he's interested. I mean, very clear. You decide what domain you have interest in, but at least incubate 25, 30, 40, 50 students whose need will be very small, but who will get even 1 hour from you in a month, you know, they will be on the right trajectory. So your in-kind investment will be more valuable than in cash investment. But the fact that they are around and you are going to airport, you ask one of them to hike with you on the car, and then on the way you can do mentoring, you know. You don't have to find extra time for that. That's how I help many of my students. I give them time. I give them time from 10 o'clock in the night to 12 o'clock in the night. You know, that's how you keep walking with them and talking to them. Most people like him will be very busy, but when they're traveling from one place to another, they can give time. Second thing I think we should do is even the large industry must set up incubators. So auto sector should set up incubator for auto innovations. The metallurgy section or mining sector should set up incubators for the mining sector. I think every industry should be encouraged, and there should be incentives by every state government and central government to encourage industry to create some allocation of funds. You know, CSR is not getting into incubation, unfortunately. Yeah. But why can't we do that? So therefore, let every industry do it. And third, every department, every ministry should announce challenge awards and an agile system to take care of the people who submit their entries. Not everybody may get award, but at least they may get a chance to take their ideas forward. So if you are in health department or you are in education department and you have a problem of enrollment, you have problem of retention, you have problem of content delivery, you know, we have 1.5 lakh post offices, 6.5 lakh villages. It is so easy to join hand with the postal department and deliver content, but where is the content to deliver in Indian languages? So I think there is a need for IT and other students to take up such challenges which our country needs. I was recently in Shodhyatra in Gurej Valley on the upper tip in Jammu Kashmir. No internet, no telephone. And children have to study there. How do we get the content to them? So please think of, you know, mesh kind of networks where you can create internet kind of broadband without using internet, you know. There is a Bangalore company which has done that. So there is a possibility of various innovations that are required for regions as remote as that, where internet fiber optic may not reach, but where networks are required locally to be able to communicate information and share them across the villages, across the schools, across the places. So we need our innovation for our own ecosystem, for our own country, for our own remote areas. And I think you will find enough people to mentor you if you are really keen to work on such problems.
Sir, basically, technology startup and disruption is one of the key theme here. And as we see, even though like we are growing very fast in this field, and there have been many, many innovations, very, very good companies like Flipkart, Ola, there, even MobiKwik founder is here. This is one of the recognition that our startups are also taking up the world. But most of the time, the disruption has come through the companies who build platform. So how do you see that in India, we are going through that capability and we can see the true disruption where we are using Indian products, we are using Indian platforms, we are using Indian technology in our day-to-day life, sir?
Yeah, so good question. You know, I think the companies that you named are creating platforms. So some of the key areas where platforms have been created the world over are e-commerce, where platform can create massive efficiencies in a in an ecosystem like ours, where most of the retail is still unorganized. And you know, organized retail is still about 10% and still inefficient. So there is a huge opportunity there in e-commerce where, you know, where which Flipkart is pursuing. Similarly, you know, what Ola is doing in terms of transportation, in terms of mobility. I mean, we, our cities are some of the worst congested in terms of traffic in the world. And, you know, we continue to buy more vehicles, more cars and more bikes, etc. So clearly, technology like Ola, where you can, you know, have on-demand transportation is going to be far more efficient over a longer term. Again, you know, it becomes a platform because it may not be restricted just to transportation in terms of just moving people, but it could it act in areas of, you know, other adjacent areas, including things like logistics. For example, you could solve point-to-point logistics using a massive supply of of delivery vehicles. Again, there, again, you know, the use of autonomous vehicles is going to happen, and the use of electric vehicles, I think, is going to happen in India, probably through some of these companies like Ola, rather than through our traditional car manufacturers. Coming back to MobiKwik, again, you know, platforms like ours, we are starting from payments, but we are building platforms for financial services, which banks, unfortunately, are not able to do so far because of the fact that the technology understanding and the penetration is not that great. The reality is that in the world of financial services, distribution and data build the platform, which is what, you know, MobiKwik is doing, connecting, you know, people who want to lend money to, for example, people who want to take loans is one of the P2P lending is one of the great ideas that has taken off, for example, in other countries, but not yet in India, where platforms like ours can be massively areas like micro insurance, right? Where in India, for example, most of the insurances has been traditionally sold through a push method, which is, you know, there's an agent who is going to call and sell you insurance. Changing that into using data to understand the insurance needs of our customers, you know, of our businesses, you know, 90% of our shopkeepers, retail shopkeepers in this country do not have fire insurance, which means that they are sitting on, you know, on a very big risk, you know, of something that they should have bought long time ago. But all that gets accessed through a technology if they're using a smartphone and a platform like ours, where payment data gets collected and behavioral data gets connected in order to provide these kind of financial services.
Thanks. You know, it's my turn to thank now everyone. You know, so concluding remark is, you know, I'm sure all of you, this has been such a thoughtful session and such great input, but I want to leave all of us with one thought. We are all Indians, mostly in this room, I'm assuming. How many of you are not from India here in the room? That's amazing. You are very lucky that you're not from India, because now I'm going to give an observation for Indians. you know, we have been brought up in an environment in our homes where we are very critical of each other and of ourselves all the time. That's a great thing because we are very humble and we are constantly challenging. In this session, we have been very critical about startups, the ecosystem, the funding and everything, because we are amazing people. We like to be very critical. You know, we like to keep on analyzing and seeing what is wrong with us. But having said that, what I found very amazing that we have people like them. We have so many, and we have people like them. We are seeing the change. We have a hall filled with people interested in the topic of startup. We have so much of money coming in the ecosystem. We have Prime Minister of this country who 2016 January said Startup India, Stand Up India. How many prime ministers, you know, the French prime minister, and everyone said it later. So there's a lot going on for this country. We have tracked 32,000 amazing startups, and the number is only growing. So very proud of the startup ecosystem, very proud that a conference like this is happening, where we're discussing, and we have such extraordinary people in this country who are sitting on this dais, and you as an audience. So let's together collaborate, make a great startup ecosystem together. And I would urge Professor Gupta, Bipin, and Saurabh that all of you please continue to be the amazing, awesome role models that you are for this country. Thank you so much. And with this, let's give a big round of applause to ourselves and to the startup ecosystem.